State University doing similar work, and for a long time with the National Park Service with the Climate Inventory and Monitoring Network in Southern Oregon and Northern California, doing a lot of the monitoring work that we're hearing about in Vermont today too. But we can get going first with our first speaker, Gus. Great. Gus Goodwin is a second-year student in the Field Naturalist program here at the University of Vermont. He graduated from Middlebury College in 2008, where he studied conservation biology, and later he worked as a field technician for the Nature Conservancy in California and the Adirondacks. An avid climber, he surprisingly took him until now to drink his academic eye towards rocks.
Can everybody hear me? My name is Gus Goodwin, and today I'll be talking about trying to predict the amount of calcium that's available in glacial till. I'm pleased to be here and happy to have the chance to share my research with you. This project was initiated by the Green Mountain National Forest because they want to better understand the spatial variability in the composition of glacial till. This is because till is the parent material for many of their soils, and they're especially interested in the variations in the amount of essential forest nutrients, such as calcium. The distribution of these nutrients has important implications for nutrient cycling, patterns of forest diversity and productivity, as well as the buffering potential of soils and streams against acidification. Ultimately, they want to incorporate this information into their land type classification scheme and their forest management decisions. Understanding the long-term nutrient supplies for forest, for particular stands will help them choose appropriate management strategies. My part in all this is to build and test a model that predicts the amount of calcium that's available in the unweathered glacial till. And along the way, lay the groundwork for future research, which would be models that predict the abundance of other elements or minerals or any other geochemical process. And the study area, is outlined in red, and the Green Mountain National Forest is shown in green. And a quick note, that's the proclamation boundary, so it's beyond the extent of the land. Before getting too far into things, I want to take a minute to thank the folks who've been so helpful along the way. It's been one of the best parts of this project is working with excited and generous people. So again, with the sponsor for the project, Diane Burbank, the ecologist for the Green Mountain Finger Lakes National Forest, my project advisor, Scott Bailey, academic committee of Jeffrey Hughes, Jen Pontius, and Don Ross, the Vermont Geological Survey, especially Marjorie Gale, and Stephen Wright, and George Springsteen. Thank you, too, for other folks who don't appear on this slide. The model I'm working with relies on identifying the source envelope, and so that's the geographic area where the rocks that compose the till at a given site could have come from. So if you take a look at this figure here, this is a map of characteristic bedrock formations in Vermont and New Hampshire, and where you find fragments of those formations across the state. So as the glacier went across the state this way, you picked up chunks of those rocks and put them out in these kind of somewhat predictable fans. And if you invert that, that's the source area for response. So looking over here, for any given site here, the rocks that are in the till there are derived from this wedge-shaped source area. And that's at the heart of the model I'm using. And the variables I'm going to manipulate are the length of that wedge, so that would be how far rocks are being transported. The angle that I use is the central azimuth, so it's a proxy for glacial direction, and then the arc, depending on which would stand for the amount of variability in flow. And also experimenting with a distance weighting so that parts in this area don't count the same as parts in that area. And I should admit, I'm not finished with this project yet, but I've developed a number of intermediate products along the way that I hope will be of interest to this crowd. Beginning with a database of bedrock geochemistry. I spent a few months combing through published and unpublished literature looking for records of chemical analyses of bedrock types. And what I did that I hope will be useful to others is try and tie them based on a location or a description match to the formations that are mapped on the new 2011 Vermont State map. And I have over 600 samples from the study area that together give geochemical profiles 84 bedrock formations. And if you've seen the new map, you know it's done in exquisite detail and that there are many more than 84 units in that study area. But you can see the geographic extent, shown in green, red and blue. Of the units that we have data for, it's quite large, so we have many of the major players. But for the model, we do want to be able to assign at least a calcium value to the remaining units. And so, again, acknowledging Marjorie Gale was instrumental in this process, we developed a classification scheme and grouped all 478 of the units into these 17 groups based on calcium. And that's what the extent of those units across the state. And I know this is way too much text to take in the short time I'm going to let you look at it. But the important thing to note is that there are five major groups based on origin of rock, and then there's subcategories based on the amount of calcium that should be in those particular units. And with the database, I hope that we're able to assign an estimate of calcium to each of those subgroups. And ultimately, create a map of calcium availability across the month. So high calcium areas shown in dark blue, low calcium areas shown in light blue. And this map was the input to the model. So with, remember the wedge. So at a given site, it's looking at the amount of calcium in the different rock types within that source area, coming up with an average of sorts. So each pixel is assigned to the average calcium value. And this is what it might look like. So this is a preliminary draft, is yet to be tested, but I included it here because I wanted to show you the type of product you're trying to develop. So this is an untested draft of the amount of calcium that would be available unweathered till for the Green Mountain National Forest. There's lots of calcium shown in red and less calcium shown in blue. And so this fall I visited 10 sites to try and collect data to either test the model's accuracy and also improve its fit. Because the model doesn't account for any sort of weathering, try to get as deep into the till as possible. Try to get below the weathering horizon. To do that, we took advantage of the landslides left by Hurricane Irene. I was able in some places to get 20 feet below sea horizon contact, which is pretty deep. A lot deeper than I could get with that little shovel. So at each site, I took an analysis of the fine sediments that were sent off to a lab for bulk chemistry. And then I also did a pebble count, so I took the first 100 rocks out of each pit and brought them back to the lab as a representative sample. And still working through these, but here are three such pits. And these are really important to the analysis because I'll be able to tie the information derived from the pits back to those variables I mentioned earlier. So for example, looking in one of these pits to find a particularly distinctive rock type, thank you. And also a distinctive rock type being able to trace that back to the formation it came from based on the bedrock map. So that would give information about how far the rocks are being transported, and looking at the way those rocks contribute to the overall composition of the pit, should be able to get at the distance weighting parts of which types of rocks are being represented more in a pit. And also, by comparing them to the analysis of the fine sediments, we'll be able to look at how well the larger rocks work the chemistry of the fine sediments. I should note the samples, I guess, are coming back on Monday. A few initial things I'd like to share from the pebble count pits is Stephen Wright helped me work through them, and most of them we saw no evidence of ice flow from the northeast, which is great news for us because we used the predominant ice flow from the northwest. But there are striation data in this area that suggest at some point and at some level some ice flow from the northeast, particularly here in the Vermont Valley. This is Manchester, which we have here. So this is an area where we might see ice flow from the northeast affecting the composition of the till. But we do, at that site, which is the one at the end of the arrow here, see rocks, this medicinal stone, are derived from the tectonic. So we're seeing lots of flow from the northwest. And this site is also kind of a neat one to end on because it shows the importance of till model. So it's mapped as being on top of the gneiss, but the vast majority of the pit is composed of quartzites and rocks derived from the west. So we'll wait for the chemistry to come back, but it should be quite different than the underlying bedrock would suggest. So up next for me is running the model a number of different times using different shaped wedges to try and generate a suite of models and a suite of predictions that I can then test against the actual observed values in the field, as well as some archive samples. And then be able to hopefully select one that's an appropriate fit and make that the recommendation. think I've left enough time for questions. So thank you very much for your attention. Weathering of the parent material into the soil horizon that match might be.